loving kindness as the flood. When the prince of life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Who is love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise. He can never be forgotten throughout heaven's eternal.
Wonderful.
A friend of mine, the nuns grow these down her road, and that was in my garden yesterday.
Oh, nice.
Oh, it smells,
yeah. Oh, it does. Because nowadays, sometimes you don't get flowers. Yes.
I know. Oh. This is Dan, is it?
This is Dan.
I can't recognise him. Hi, Dan.
Well, I think we were going on this one, actually. It might, yeah, it was this one coming back. So it's that one going there, but this one coming back. But I actually thought this was a nicer path to take, actually, so I'm glad they've chosen this one.
Family and friends, we are gathered here to lay to rest the earthly body of our dear friend Peter Lewis. He was a great man of God who holds a very special place in our hearts. For as well as being a loving and devoted husband, father and grandfather to Valerie, Calvin, Justin, Miley, Cara, Nico, there are countless of thousands of others around the country and indeed around the world whose lives have been encouraged, enriched and blessed by Peter's incredible ministry as a pastor, a Bible teacher and a wise and loving friend. God gave us a great gift in Peter, and our lives are the richer and the better for having known him. Though we are sad for his earthly passing, we rejoice in his heavenly reward and hope, which is found entirely upon his faith and trust in the risen Lord Jesus Christ, to whom he devoted his life. Listen to these reassuring words of scripture, which John will read out to us and are on our program.
Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live, even though they die." And the Apostle Paul said, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither heights nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord."
Let's bow for a word of prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that neither life nor death nor anything else can ever separate your people from the love that is found in Christ Jesus, our Lord. We thank you that because Jesus is the resurrection and the life, we know that death holds no terror for those who have placed their faith and trust in Christ, the risen Lord. We ask that you would draw near to all who mourn this day, Bring your comfort to our grieving hearts, that we might find strength and consolation through your Holy Spirit. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're going to sing a lovely Welsh hymn, which speaks of the hymn writer's amazement at God's mercy and love in sending Jesus to die for our sin. Here is love, vast as the ocean. Of service, we're going to have another reading, which I'm going to ask John to read as well, taken from 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 and 4.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you.
Friends, for the 26 years that I've known Peter, he always struck me as someone who was full of joy. Of course, he had two very good reasons for being joyful. For a start, he had Valerie, without whom his ministry and life would have been greatly impoverished. For they were an incredible team together. Their love, their care, and hospitality towards all who came into their lives was second to none. Peter had been the minister at Cornerstone Church for 46 years, an astonishing achievement. He and Valerie, under God's blessing, grew the church from its small beginnings of just a few dozen people to over 1,000. Over his many years of ministry, literally thousands of people, young and old, have been impacted, blessed and encouraged through his outstanding preaching and through his books. We are indebted to him for leaving such a great spiritual legacy behind. And we are grateful to God for giving us such a warm and loving pastor. The second and most important reason why Peter was a man of great joy and praise was because of Jesus. It was in Peter's early teens that Peter finally grasped hold of the most amazing truth that anybody could ever come to know. That God so loved him that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for him in order that he might be forgiven and reconciled to God and have eternal life. For although Peter had grown up attending church, he had failed to grasp his own great need of Christ, perhaps thinking his good deeds might be sufficient to earn his way to heaven. Until one evening, a visiting Christian speaker unpacked the good news about Jesus, and he explained to Peter how Jesus lived the perfect life which we ourselves have failed to do. And out of his love and mercy, he bore our guilt on the cross for all of our wrongs, taking the punishment that our sins rightfully deserved, in order that through Christ's death on the cross, we could be forgiven and clothed in Christ's righteousness and be given eternal life through Christ's resurrection from the dead, and enter into a new and living relationship with God as our Heavenly Father. Speaking about his own conversion, Peter said this: "That night in my bedroom, I knelt and committed myself as a sinner to the one who had died for me. I was 14 years old. My first sermon was preached when I was 15 years old. And ever since, I have been an expository preacher who has never ceased to find in the scriptures the voice of God and the centrality of Christ." That decision which Peter took to accept his need of Christ and to give his life to follow him altered not only his life, but this moment that we are witnessing here today. Peter once said to me that when he was first diagnosed with cancer, he said this: "I am trusting Jesus Christ in who he claimed to be as the Son of God, and I am trusting in all of his promises that he has made to me, especially this one where Jesus said, 'I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though they die.'" You see, Peter could face death confidently because he placed his faith and trust in Christ as his Savior. He trusted in all that Christ had achieved for him on the cross, paying for the sins of the world, offering us his forgiveness, and granting us a living relationship with him. Jesus conquered death's power and ultimate hold over us when God raised Christ from the dead. For there is an empty tomb in Jerusalem to this very day because Jesus walked out of it alive. And that moment in history 2,000 years ago affects this moment today. For death does not have the final word. Jesus does. And he offers to all who will come to him a share in his eternal life if we will accept him as our personal Lord and Savior. And one day Jesus Christ will return to this earth, and the earthly body of Peter and those who place their faith and trust in Christ as their Savior will be raised to a new and glorified body that will never see decay and will live on a renewed earth. Friends, we were designed for life, not death. We were designed for this world with all of its beauties, but without any of its cruelties. And we were made to live and to dwell with God forever. And the last book of the Bible paints a very beautiful picture of this, where John writes, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away." That's this one. "And I saw a holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now amongst his people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" You know, some of the last words that Peter said to me was a quote that the Apostle Paul said in the Bible when he thought about heaven. He said this, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived for the things that God has promised for those who loved him." And as he said those words, Peter's eyes widened and brightened at the whole prospect of heaven, in much the same way that a child's eyes would light up as they gaze into a sweetie shop. He was looking forward to this. Yes, Jesus Christ was Peter's eternal hope and joy, a hope that has never disappointed him, nor diminished in its power to save. Jesus Christ was Peter's great delight, his source of strength, his rock, his redeemer, his shepherd, his friend, his motive for living, and his assurance in dying. And you too, standing here, my friends, can have that same hope if you will accept this Saviour and the forgiveness that he offers and the eternal life that goes with it. That was Peter's hope, and I trust it will one day, if not now, be the hope of everyone gathered here, because that's what Peter would have wanted me to say. Before we commit the body of Peter to the ground, let's pause and thank God for all that he has meant for us in our hearts as our friends come and gather around us to lower his bodily remains. And as we lower the coffin, listen to these reassuring words from God's own word. "I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. O sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, for they will rest from their labors."
Thank you, gentlemen.
as it has been the will of the Lord our God to call away the earthly life of our loved one Peter, we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, confidently expecting the resurrection from the dead of all those who place their faith and hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For the dead shall hear his voice and shall rise to eternal life. Friends, we close with a lovely song. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. And it's in our order of service. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace through his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
friends, our time has come to an end, and perfect timing, it's raining now and not before. But as you leave, we'd love to be able to give you some books that we brought with us. If you'd like to take one, feel free, and they'll be available as people are heading into the car park. So thank you so much on behalf of Valerie and the family for coming. I believe, I don't want to speak out of turn, but those that are able to stay and come, is that right?
Yeah.
Can come to Hatchings Farm. I've never been there, so don't follow me. But thank you so much for coming and showing your love and your appreciation and supporting the family. God bless you. We trust you're always welcome to come and visit Peter's Church, Cornerstone Church in Castle Boulevard.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years.